Get Rich Education is brought to you by Valhalla Wealth and Ridge Lending Group.
You're listening to the show that has created more passive income for people than nearly any show in the world. This is the powerful Get Rich Education.
Welcome to GRE, Get Rich Education, episode 168, recorded here right before Christmas Day. Merry Christmas, happy holidays. I'm your host, Keith Weinhold, and Rich Dad Advisor Tom Wheelwright and I are back to help you build your wealth. What's more Christmassy than talking about taxes? Well, frankly, just about anything, but we've got Tom back once again today for an all-new show as we're going to discuss how to permanently reduce your taxes. First, as you're out there, invest for income. Just three emphatic words, invest for income. If you're not investing for income, then you're really just speculating on capital appreciation. You're hoping. Well, then where do various asset classes derive their income from? Well, for stocks income, it's the dividend. Well, most dividends are small and many stocks pay zero dividend at all. The S&P 500 stocks pay a dividend of 2% annually. The more likely that you're in a growth-oriented stock, like a young stock where you expect rapid growth, well, then the less likely that that stock is to pay a dividend, because rather than paying out a dividend, younger growth stocks, instead, they reinvest their money. They reinvest that capital back into research and development instead of paying it out to you in the form of a dividend. So with stocks, the income is called a dividend. That is an unspectacular rate of return. For bonds, the income is called a coupon. That's an unspectacular rate of return. Gold, that pays you zero ongoing income. Cryptos like Bitcoin and Ethereum pays you zero ongoing income. Real estate, that pays you monthly ongoing rent. Besides investing for income, invest your time and money into things that are going to have value for a long time, things that are going to be around. Housing has value. People will continue to pay you to live somewhere. Food has value because people need to eat. And so sometimes we talk about creating cash flow here from agricultural real estate where you own title to the land yourself. How about thirdly, your body, your own physical body has value. You're going to be living inside it for the rest of your life. So if exercising is a hobby of yours, that's perfect because you need to be doing it anyway. Energy has value. So invest in things that both provide income and have long-term value. Well, real estate's one of those things that pays income and it's going to be around for a long time. It's not discretionary because it's vital to every human's existence. And additionally, now everyone's greatest expense in life, everyone out there, their greatest expense in life is taxes. Well, that tax can also greatly be shielded if your shield is real estate that you're directly invested in. Now, Tom Wheelwright was here 2 weeks ago to discuss some new tax policy expected and how that affects you and your wallet. But today, we're talking about how you can do more with the tax laws that have already been in place because so many people are not using those to their advantage. And this is just like leverage lying in wait for you. Now, we don't usually focus on cutting expenses here at Get Rich Education, right? Don't live below your means. Expand your means rather than focusing on reducing your expenses and using that outright swear word of budgeting. Instead, focus on increasing your income because there's an unlimited upside to increasing your income. If you just focus on your downside, well, then you can only cut down so much, plus you're reducing your standard of living all the while. But with taxes, it's different. Now, that's an expense that you want to reduce because when you do, you haven't diminished your quality of life one bit. You're actually going to increase it. Tom and I are going to discuss the tax laws, real estate professional designation. That is a substantial tax break that United States citizens can qualify for that can really help you. We're really going to drill down and find out how you can get qualified. Now, what if you manage your own property or what if you outsource management to somebody else? Does that weigh in to whether or not you can qualify for the cherished real estate professional designation? What about the real estate transfer tax? Depending on what state you live in, that can really drag down your profitability. For example, Pennsylvanians know this. Pennsylvania is the state where I've lived most of my life, and they famously got an annoying transfer tax. We're covering all that and more. We're coming right back. It'll be Rich Dad Advisor, Tom Wheelwright, and I. This is the show that's created more passive income for people than nearly any show in the world. This is Get Rich Education. Cashflow real estate investors, if you're looking for a mortgage loan with a company that specializes in investment property loans, it's Ridge Lending Group. They provide income property loans in almost every U.S. state. Ridge has worked with tens of thousands of investors and homeowners all over the country. In fact, with ethics and transparency, they've helped more people realize their dreams through real estate investing than any other mortgage lender in the country. Get started at RidgeLendingGroup.com. MC Laubscher is the host of the top-rated business and investing podcast, Cashflow Ninja, and also the president and chief wealth strategist of Valhalla Wealth. They help busy people build wealth outside of Wall Street by strategically combining their clients' cash flow statements with the financial vehicle of the wealthy, according to the infinite banking concept. If you are interested to learn how to perpetually multiply your wealth, you can access an exclusive webinar at yourownbankingsystem.com.
Hi, this is Russell Gray, co-host of the Real Estate Guys radio show, and you're listening to Get Rich Education with Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
You probably already know who today's guest is because he's been the most recurrent guest in Get Rich Education history. He actually makes taxes fun. Yeah, those two words don't usually go together. He's the founder and visionary of ProVision, based in Tempe, Arizona. They really are the top tax planning firm on the planet. He is the tax advisor for Robert Kiyosaki and for me as well. We're both contributing writers at the Rich Dad Advisors blog. He's the best-selling author of the book Tax-Free Wealth. And in 2017, he and Robert Kiyosaki co-authored the book Why the Rich Are Getting Richer. Welcome back to Get Rich Education, Rich Dad Advisor, Tom Wheelwright.
Thanks, Keith. Always good to be here.
Tom, we're so glad to have you back. One of the things I talk about with the listeners, oftentimes we have listeners that are saving money, or I actually like to use the term they're getting liquid prior to buying their next property, because I think saving money sort of reinforces the wrong mindset. But in any case, one thing I often remind the listeners about, Tom, is, well, why don't you look at what you already have to work with? Oftentimes, you don't need to go grind to come up with additional funds to try to get one more property this year or whatever. Deal with what you've already got. And one of those things that you've already got is the tax law that really oftentimes works for a real estate investor in the United States. So why don't you just talk to us a little bit more about the motivations behind reducing your tax expense, which is often the quickest way to get an ROI with what you've already got.
There's no question. Actually, I always say the fastest way to put money in your pocket is to reduce your taxes.
Yeah.
It's also the easiest and the cheapest. Think about this. Let's say, so on average, when we have a new investor entrepreneur come to us, in 3 months, we're going to reduce their taxes by 10 to 40%. And it's permanent. It takes some time. It takes some money, et cetera. Let's say it costs $10,000 to do that. I mean, that's a lot of money. But what if you reduce your taxes by $20,000 a year? That's a 50% ROI, and it's a tax-free ROI because you don't get a deduction for federal taxes. So any tax money you save goes right into your pocket. And the thing is with real estate is it's so easy if you have a good plan of action in place, and call it a strategy. If you have that plan of action, literally there are things you could be doing every single day to reduce your taxes. You got to think of it this way. Every dollar you earn is either taxable or not taxable. It's either taxable at a high rate or a low rate. And every dollar you spend is either deductible or not deductible. It can create a tax benefit or not, or it can create multiple tax benefits. This new tax bill we talked about a few weeks ago actually creates some opportunities to make money by donating to charities in certain states. So the opportunities to make money on taxes, another one, a conservation easement, which, you know, a lot of people in real estate are somewhat familiar with the idea of, because they, let's say they want, they've got a big, beautiful ranch or something like that. They really don't want it developed. Okay. They want to make sure nobody develops, or they want to make sure that the property around them doesn't get developed. Well, they can actually put an easement on there, which force that is permanent and nobody can ever develop. So typically we think we want to be able to develop, but what they don't realize is there's a charitable contribution deduction for that. And you can actually do it just as an investment. You can actually invest in conservation easement. You don't have to own the property. The return on investment, if you're in a 40% tax bracket, is right around 60%, and it's immediate. So there's just a lot of things you can do to bring money in your pocket really, really fast, and it doesn't take a lot of money to get there.
See, a conservation easement, that's a sort of creative thing that most tax strategists don't talk about. And by creative, we're still talking about something completely within the law. And you should have every motivation to reduce your tax expense, the biggest expense that you're going to have in life. One of the annoying things about taxes as an expense is you don't get anything out of having that expense. If you spend $5,000 on a holiday ski trip with your family, well, you got a holiday ski trip out of it. Typically, with every expense, you have a net benefit, but you really don't have that when you pay your taxes. And you know what, Tom? I was just telling someone yesterday, I was really instilling a motivation in them to learn more about tax reduction, because here's the thing. People don't typically agree with the way the government spends their tax money. If you don't agree with war and just say you don't like the fact that the government spends a lot of money on war, well, quit funding their war. Go ahead and reduce your taxes to the maximum extent that you possibly and legally can. If you think the government spends too much on unemployment and welfare programs and you don't like that, well, that should give you another motivation to reduce your taxes, because every additional tax dollar you're giving to them is going to these things oftentimes that you don't agree with. So it's just ridiculous to think that the government can ever spend your dollar for you better than you could. So you should want to have every motivation possible to retain that yourself. And us as real estate investors, we know how to reinvest that dollar and get a good return from it as well. So there should be so much motivation for a real estate investor, especially to want to reduce that tax expense. You don't get anything out of it, and it's often spent in ways you don't agree with.
Well, that's true. And here's another way to look at it. You're a partner with the government. The government's your partner. No matter whether you like it or not, they're your partner. And they can either be a bad partner or a good partner. And you get to choose. If you do nothing, they're going to be a bad partner. They're going to take 40% or more of your hard-earned money, and they're going to spend it however they want to. Like you said, not how you want to, however they want to. That they're going to take that money from you. Now, they can be a good partner, because what they've done is they've given you an instruction guide. It's called the Internal Revenue Code, and we basically pull all the important stuff into tax-free wealth. That's why I wrote the book Tax-Free Wealth, so you don't have to read the Internal Revenue Code, because I'm one of the few people who actually enjoys reading the Internal Revenue Code. Most people, it would just put them to sleep. I wrote Tax-Free Wealth so you could actually have an interesting opportunity to learn a little bit about taxes and what to do, and pull those things that are really important to you. But the point is that the tax law is this instruction guide. And when you look at that instruction guide, okay, it's an instruction guide to how do I make the government a better partner, and how do I become a better partner to the government? It goes both ways. See, the government, what do they want to do? They want to do a couple of things. They want to reduce unemployment, right? They want to stimulate the economy. They want to build housing. They want to encourage economic development. There are some things that are very specific they want you to do. They want to encourage agriculture very specifically. They want to include energy, both clean energy and oil and gas and coal. They want to encourage all energy, because the U.S., which is, by the way, we're one of the few places where you can actually own energy, right? Normally the government owns the energy sources. And so they're going to give you an incentive, and depending on which energy you want, you know, whatever you want to invest in, there's an energy incentive there. There's a tax incentive. So what the government's telling you is, if you do what we want you to do, we will reduce your taxes. We're going to give you that benefit. Oil and gas is a really interesting one, because you get a tax benefit on the front end, but unlike most situations, when you get paid, you don't have to pay tax on it. You know, real estate's a lot that way, from the standpoint that though you don't get a real big benefit on the front end, but you might get some repairs, deductions, et cetera, but you don't ever have to pay tax on the income or the gain. So what's the government saying there? The government's saying, look, if you don't invest in real estate, we're going to tax you one way. If you do invest in real estate, we're going to tax you another way. If you don't invest in oil and gas, we're going to tax you one way. If you do, we're going to tax you another way. If you don't invest in business, we're going to tax you one way. If you do invest in business, we're going to tax you another way. That's all they're saying. They're just saying, look, this is what we would like to have happen. We're willing to give you an incentive to make it happen. And the government, not just the U.S. government, this is true around the world, governments have learned that, just like you say, people hate paying taxes. There's an emotional consequence to paying a tax. It's not a good one, okay? People hate the idea of paying tax. We get that there's basic services we need from the government. Just none of us believe that they should cost trillions of dollars. So what do we do about it? Well, it's easy. Do what the government tells you to do. Fill out that roadmap. We call it a tax strategy. And pay less tax.
Right. If you think you can't do something about government spending, you actually can. And that is, don't go ahead and fund it yourself. Tom, I want to go ahead and talk about the real estate professional designation. I know that you and I discussed that before, but that might have been a couple years. And, you know, that's something really valuable to people. A while ago, I was doing an episode on quitting your job. If you want to quit your day job and start your daydream, some of those things that you need to think about to get your plan in place, you know, one of those is you're going to want your passive income to exceed the active income that you're relinquishing from your job. You might want to qualify for all the loans that you possibly can and get those closed before you leave your job. You probably want to get a health insurance plan in place somehow and figure out what you're going to do there before you quit your job. Oftentimes, one of the consequences of quitting your job could potentially mean that now you qualify for the real estate professional designation because of the way that that's structured. So tell us about those requirements for the real estate professional designation that the IRS gives you.
Sure. Let's back up a little bit and say, why is it important? Real estate losses are what we call passive losses. As a general rule, that's the general rule. They're passive losses. And as a general rule, passive losses can only offset passive income. Well, think about what's passive income. So we know that real estate losses are passive. What's passive income? Well, it's income from a business that you own that's a flow-through entity. It's like a partnership or an S corporation. So portfolio income is not passive, all right? So in other words, a dividend from your Procter & Gamble, that's not passive income, that's portfolio income. And unless you have passive income, you can't use those passive losses to offset the income that's being taxed. So most people have a tough time having enough passive taxable income that they can use their real estate losses. So you're really, what you're doing is you're giving up a big asset. You got this huge real estate losses that are coming from depreciation, not costing you a dime, and you're not getting a benefit of it. So you've got a basically an asset, an underutilized asset in a tax benefit that's just sitting there. So what do? Well, there are a couple of things you can do. One of the things you can do is actually convert some of your active income to passive income. That's one thing you can do, and we can show you how to do that. The other thing is one you're talking about, which is you can become a real estate professional. If you're a real estate professional, then your real estate losses are no longer passive. Now they're active, and they can be used against any income. They can be used against your spouse's wages, your business income. They can be used against any other income and offset that income, those losses, and so that it's kind of a get-out-of-jail-free card. So the real estate professional designation is very, very simple. Okay, it's very simple. There are two rules. The first rule is you have to spend more than 750 hours doing real estate during the year. The second rule is you have to spend more time on real estate than all your other business activities combined. Now, there's a couple of nice things about this. First of all, it's you or your spouse. So your spouse can have a full-time job or a full-time business, and you quit your job and become the real estate professional. Together, you get all those benefits of being a real estate professional, get all those benefits of your real estate losses. So it's only one of you that has to be a real estate professional. It does require good documentation. Okay. One thing that I would tell everybody is if you believe that you might qualify for a real estate professional, you must keep a log. You really have to keep a log of your hours, both your real estate hours and your non-real estate hours, because it has to be more than your other business activities. Now, some things you don't have to do. You don't have to be a real estate broker or get a real estate license. You don't have to do that. You could be a contractor. You could be manage your own properties. You can be a developer. I mean, anything, all these things qualify for real estate professional. There's actually a list of seven. Some things don't qualify. A real estate broker qualifies. And actually, a real estate agent, your time spent, as long as you own the agency, it qualifies. What doesn't qualify is if you're just a pure investor. You're not actively involved in any of the real estate, and all you do is look at reports and numbers and stuff like that. You don't do anything that's active in the real estate. You're not going to be a real estate professional. So that's actually a pretty big designation, pretty big difference. However, if you have both real estate professional hours, in other words, active management type hours, and you have some investor hours, you get to add them together. So you can add those together but you have to at least have some really active real estate investor. So this is a huge tax benefit, Keith. I'm glad you bring it up to our listeners, because if you're going to do real estate full time, you really probably ought to qualify as a real estate professional. You just have to keep a log and make sure you keep track of a few things so that when the IRS comes knocking on your door, because if they do knock on your door, they will challenge your real estate professional status.
Wow, there's some great stuff in there and some really important distinctions. And you know, Tom, how I'm often talking on the show about, now, let's think big picture here. You want to build the best lifestyle that you possibly can and have real estate fuel that. And I often talk about the importance of scalability and the scalability of the mindset and the action that you don't manage your own property. Because if you try to manage your own property, how big or how scalable can you really get, especially if you're still working a day job? If you go ahead and outsource your management, is that like a significant impediment to you qualifying for real estate professional designation status? Or just give us a little bit more color on that one there.
It actually could be. Here's the way to look at it. If you've made real estate your business, you're going to qualify. But if you think of real estate as just something that's really hands-off and you're not really developing it as a business, it's going to be passive even if you spend 2,000 hours a year at it. So I think that the really successful real estate investors are those that are actively involved in some way. They're looking at it like a business. I've got to manage my people. I've got to manage my team. I'm reviewing reports. I'm actively involved in this. I have clients that are big real estate developers. Okay. I mean, do you think Ken McElroy manages his properties? No, of course not. But he's a real estate professional because he runs it like a business. So he's very active. He's finding properties, you know, he's raising money, he's doing all sorts of things that are not investor type hours, they're actual real estate hours. And the key is that he's treating it like a business. That's what they want. They're saying, are you a professional in the real estate business? And if you're just letting somebody else do it and you don't really take an active role in it, you're not in business.
Can you give us some other examples beyond just Ken McElroy of someone that's qualified for the real estate professional designation, but yet they're not managing their own property? What are some of the other situations that someone might fall into where they're classified that way?
Let's say that you have a portfolio, okay, of real estate. And let's say you've got one property. You've got one property that you may invest with other people even on a lot of your properties, but you got one or two big properties that, you know what, you're actively working with the tenants. You're actively working with the construction, the contractors to improve the property. You're checking to make sure it's maintained properly. You're not managing it per se. In other words, you're not a day-to-day manager, but you're very seriously involved in it. Again, I just look at it as business. If it's a business for you, then you're going to qualify as a real estate professional. If it's not a business for you and it's a casual activity, or it's an activity that, I mean, think about it, 750 hours, that's 15 hours a week. That's not a light activity. You are putting some serious time into that. So I actually think it's pretty hard. If you're putting 800 or 1,000 hours a year into real estate, I think it's pretty hard not to be a real estate professional.
Right. So some takeaways are, document your activities that you're performing in order to get that 750 hours to be a real estate professional. And then the reminder that, yeah, it's pretty unlikely that you're going to qualify as a real estate professional designation if you do work a full-time day job, because your principal activity, it needs to be in real estate, is one of the criterion for going ahead and getting that designation.
That's true. I mean, think about it. If you spend 2,000 hours at your day job, that means you got to spend 2,001 in real estate. That's tough.
Right.
It can be done. There are actually court cases that suggest it can be done, but it's challenging. By the way, there's one other thing that you have to do. There's an election that you have to make on your tax return. And I've seen this election missed, and you cannot make it on an amended return. So you must make this election. And it's called an aggregation election. If you do not make that election, you are not going to be a real estate professional. So just remember that. It's an aggregation election. Talk to your tax preparer about it. If they don't make it, it doesn't matter how much time you spend. You are not going to be a real estate professional.
Wow. I am really glad that you brought that up. Well, Tom, we know that a savvy real estate investor wants to go ahead and turn their money over and use the velocity of money. Oftentimes, that ends up with being a vehicle like a 1031 tax deferred exchange. But, you know, a lot of times I hear from listeners about the transfer tax, the real estate transfer tax, the tax that you pay when the title of real property is transferred. Sometimes a real estate transfer tax is also called a conveyance tax. You might see it called that in some states. And, you know, that is a hindrance often to exchanging up and increasing your leverage ratio into more and larger properties with just using the equity from existing properties. One thing I really like about you, Tom, is that you do say don't let the tax tail wag the dog. You know, sometimes these things are considerations that we make, but one impediment is that transfer tax. And I think we see higher transfer taxes, especially in some of the northeastern states. Some U.S. states don't have transfer taxes at all. By the way, Europe often has 2-4% transfer taxes. We're talking about percentages of the sale amount. But in some places, like especially the northeastern states of the U.S., you see transfer taxes. I know Pennsylvanians have a 1% transfer tax when they go ahead and transfer the title of their property. So you have any thoughts about transfer tax or how one can best deal with that?
Yeah, first of all, one of the issues is, do I have the cash to do the trade up, right? It's an expense of the sale. That's what it is. I mean, you also have real estate commissions. You also have, you know, title company. You have other things, right? So you have to build that into, should I sell this property or not? But here's the thing. You can borrow, okay? You just have to plan for it. You can't borrow right before you do your 1031 exchange, but you can borrow a few months before or a few months after. So you can get the cash, or the transfer taxes may just be paid as part of the transaction, and then you don't even have to use your cash. I'm just saying that the transfer tax, it's there. It is really hard to avoid. There are some places that you can use. I don't believe Pennsylvania is one of these, but there are some places where you can actually do a structure with land trusts and you can avoid the transfer tax that way. Pennsylvania is not one of those. But there are some planning opportunities. I will tell you, they're really challenging because they want those transfer taxes. So I think personally, the better approach is, let's look at, what's my leverage? Am I going to increase my leverage by selling this property? Or do what I want to do is, do I want to refinance the property and use that money to buy the next property as opposed to selling the property? That would avoid a transfer tax. I've never understood, if you have a property you like, why are you selling it? It makes no sense to me. Even in a 1031 transaction, it makes no sense. Why are you selling the property? It's a good property, don't sell it. If it's a bad property, you don't want it anyway. So sell it. You know, I don't think this decision is that hard. And people try to make it that hard. Here's the way I look at it. The purpose of an asset is to create cash flow. It's that simple. If your asset's not creating cash flow, it's not an asset. And if it's creating not very much cash flow, it's an underperforming asset. So maybe it's time to reposition those dollars so that they are performing for you, because you're losing out. You talk about velocity. The worst drag on velocity is an underperforming asset. That's the biggest drag on your velocity, is you got something that's not working for you. So I'm just saying, look, get your velocity going by making sure that your asset's doing its job. What's the purpose of a liability? The purpose of a liability is to buy an asset. So if you've got a liability out there and it's not creating that asset, why'd you get the liability in the first place? You need to figure out how to get rid of that liability. It's like credit card debt that's not being used, personal debt. That's why it's bad debt, right? It's not creating cash flow. The whole job of the investor is to create cash flow. And so whatever it takes, I mean, if we've got a good property, we got a good property. We've got a bad property, we've got a bad property. Now, there are those that are in between. That's where you have to do that analysis. And you go, okay, yeah, it's a good property. I'd like to get rid of it. But boy, that transfer tax is just going to take away my velocity. Then I have to look at, can I improve that rate of return? And then can I go borrow the money instead of doing the sale? So I actually think the biggest answer for that is, if you like the property in the first place, don't sell it.
Yeah, well, that was beautifully said. If you can transfer a liability into an asset, then it's pretty likely that it's worth paying the transfer tax if the state that you're doing business in has one. And yeah, this transfer tax, that is just one consideration among so many between the age-old question, should you do a cash-out refinance or should you use a 1031 exchange to go ahead and amplify your leverage and increase your velocity of money? Tom, when it comes to transfer taxes, how do LLCs fit into that? If you want to transfer a property from your personal name into an LLC or BAC or do any other sort of structure, how do transfer taxes work with those?
Yeah, it depends on the state. Some states, if you transfer into an LLC that you own, you pay a transfer tax. That's nasty. Hawaii, you have to pay really close attention to that. I actually was able to get one by where I put it into an LLC and they did not charge me the transfer tax. Generally speaking, Hawaii will charge you a transfer tax for putting your assets into your own LLC, even though you own 100%. Just have to look at the rules. The reality is there are some transfer taxes. If you own 100% of the LLC, they don't apply. So what do? You own 100% of the LLC. Let's say it's you and a partner. And you go, okay, well, I'm going to own 100% of this LLC until I do the transfer. And then I'm going to bring my partner in. That's easy tax planning. Okay, so look at what the rules say for your state as to how the transfer tax applies. That's why you've got to have professionals. You've got to have people who understand how to read the law, because there's always an exception. There's almost always a way to deal with that.
Yeah. Well, great stuff, Tom. That was really good on motivation for paying as little tax as possible, maximizing or taking advantage of the real estate professional designation, and then planning considerations for the transfer tax. Any final thoughts our listeners should know about?
You know, to me, the biggest motivation is it's I can't reach my dream with paying high tax. The numbers don't work. You cannot get there. So paying high tax, it's not an option if you ever want to reach your dream. Whatever that dream is, whether it's more time with your family, whether it's a bigger house, whether it's a place on the beach, whether it's charity, whatever that dream is, literally, it is impossible to get there paying high taxes. So I would just say that for $15 or $13, I don't know what it is, buy tax-free wealth. I mean, it's cheap, right? Start there. Get educated. And once you get educated, it's just amazing how low your taxes can come. And if you become a real professional in real estate, your taxes can absolutely get to zero.
Taxes can keep you middle class, but knowing taxes can help make you wealthy. Tom, how can our listeners find out more about you and all the progressive things that you're really doing, the innovative stuff that you're really doing to help out taxpayers and especially real estate investors?
Just join us at taxfreewealthadvisor.com. You can sign up for our free report there, taxfreewealthadvisor.com. Sign up for a free report. It's a weekly report. It gives you all sorts of information. As you, I think, mentioned previously, we do have a really good educational product called Tax Free Formula that we do a launch maybe twice a year. It's available. And so if you sign up for the free report, then we'll notify you of when that's coming. So you'll be able to get into that, because you only have like a week in order to buy it, and then it's done for another 6 months. So we do that on purpose. We want people to pay attention. We want people to actually take an active interest in reducing their taxes, because what we always like to say is, you know, you get that those taxes down, your financial freedom is a lot closer than you think.
Tom's talking about his fantastic video course. It's called Tax Free Formula. It really brings taxes to life and actually makes them interesting. I really recommend it. Check out taxfreewealthadvisor.com. Tom Wheelwright, thanks so much for coming back onto the show.
Thanks, Keith.
Well, great stuff from Tom as usual. In the show notes, we've put a chart that shows how much transfer tax one pays in each state. Tom's resources are also in the show notes for you. Coming up in the new year, we're going to be talking here on Get Rich Education about how you can do more than live a rich life. We're going to talk about how exactly and actionably you can leave a rich legacy too, as an everyday person, and you can do it much like the Rockefeller family or like the Harvard Endowment Fund does. Man, I am really looking forward to that show. Big thanks today to Rich Dad Advisor Tom Wheelwright. Until we're back here next week to help you build your wealth, I'm Keith Weinhold. Don't quit your daydream.
Nothing on this show should be considered specific, personal, or professional advice. Please consult an appropriate tax, legal, real estate, financial, or business professional for individualized advice. Opinions of guests are their own. Information is not guaranteed. All investment strategies have the potential for profit or loss. The host is operating on behalf of Get Rich Education, LLC, exclusively.
Ranked by Forbes as one of the fastest growing cities, Orlando, Florida has a big and diverse economy, yet still features affordable rental properties that cash flow. Our boots on the ground turnkey provider, Greg Bond, wrote a special report to help you discover the amazing market of Orlando. Request your free copy today. Visit getricheducation.com/Orlando. That's getricheducation.com/Orlando.
The preceding program was brought to you by your home for wealth building, getricheducation.com.